This video is brought to you by Omaze. Fossil fuels cause climate change. Climate change bad. Renewable energy good, but intermittent. Apes need stored renewable energy for scarce times. What do? Hey, come on guys, you saw the title and you're still here. Energy from rust, really. Like where? Iron has been around for ages. If there was power to be had out of it, wouldn't we have had it already? It's not like rules of physics just got a new update. Who'd fall for that kind of stuff anyway? Oh, Bill Gates, Jeff Bezos, ArcelorMittal, and it's led by the former vice president of Tesla's stationary battery division, along with this MIT guy who keeps coming up every time we look for papers on battery technology. Well, I'm pretty sure my intuition still trumps whatever experts these guys hired to vet this technology. But just in case, let's take a closer look. Iron is really common, and we know why. It is the end point of fusion within stars, so a lot of matter ends up as iron. But for a long time, it was believed to be rare. Because if there is oxygen around, iron much prefers to be bonded to that than existing on its own. And the only pure iron in ancient times came from a place with no oxygen, space. Meteorites made of iron alloy sometimes rained down on Earth and were the largest source of metallic iron in human civilization. It was 8 times as expensive as gold and considered sacred. At some point, though, humanity was able to make furnaces hot enough to smelt iron oxides, and breaking the iron-oxygen bond ignited a new era in human civilization. The premise is that iron prefers to be bonded to oxygen. That's a more favorable form of matter, energetically speaking. So there is some energy to be squeezed out when metallic iron becomes iron oxide, or rust. So technically, the energy is not stored in rust, but in the lack of rust. Let's look at a fully discharged battery. You have iron as the anode, alkaline water as the electrolyte, and an oxygen-breathing membrane as the cathode. When you charge the battery, you begin pumping electrons into the anode. Rust is red because of the characteristic color of the ferrous iron. This is bonded to hydroxyl ion. When the ferrous ion gets 2 electrons, it turns back to its metallic state. And the hydroxyl ion is pulled towards the cathode, where it gives up 4 electrons to turn into oxygen and water. The water replenishes the electrolyte and the oxygen is breathed out. When we want to use the energy stored in the battery, we need to make the iron rust. So we breathe oxygen in. With the help of a catalyst, we add electrons to the oxygen and make it dissociate into oxygen ions. These react with the water to form hydroxyl ions, which force the iron to give up its electrons and turn back into rust. I'll quickly go over the roles of the different parts. The air-breathing cathode makes sure that no impurities like carbon dioxide mess up the battery. The catalyst makes sure the oxygen coming in gets 4 electrons and not 2, because the latter would produce a peroxide ion, which can damage the components of the battery. And if you're wondering why the electrolyte is alkaline, that's because rust can dissolve in acidic media, and while recharging, you could get iron dendrites shorting the anode and cathode. The idea is to use renewables to charge these batteries and have them provide multi-day storage of electricity. Iron air batteries use really abundant and commonly used materials, so they're expected to be really cheap. Form Energy is promising $20 per kilowatt hour of storage versus $150 per kilowatt hour for lithium ion batteries and around $75 per kilowatt hour for Donald Sadoway's liquid metal batteries that we spoke about in a previous video. So even if they don't last as long as the competition, they'll still end up way cheaper. But while Form Energy doesn't mention cycle life as one of the advantages of the battery on their website, we did find this paper from the Fraunhofer Institute. It suggests that iron air batteries can have a cycle life of 10,000, which is the equivalent of 30 years. And we don't need to worry so much about the end of life with these batteries. Iron is really easy to recycle. We do it on a massive scale already, so these batteries won't make much of a dent in that capacity. And recycling these takes a lot less energy than the aluminium air batteries we spoke about in a previous video. So all that begs the question, why haven't we done it already? Is it because of big oil? Big natural gas? Big hydrogen? Is industry paying influencers to be skeptical about clean energy technology? Are they paying us? No, because this video is already paid for by Omaze. Omaze is offering you a chance to win a Tesla Model S Plaid, the fastest and the most advanced production car ever made. With a nearly 400-mile range, you're completely road trip ready. You've got a 1,000-plus horsepower electric engine on your side that can go a quarter mile in under 10 seconds with a top speed of 200 miles per hour. That's pretty amazing. Now, Omaze works with charities, and in this case, it's Reverb. Reverb partners with musicians, festivals, and venues to green their concerts while engaging fans face-to-face at shows to take environmental and social action. Their work makes a real positive impact on the environment, including the elimination of 3 million plus single-use plastic water bottles at concerts, supporting 2,000 family farmers, elevating the work of 4,000 local and national nonprofits, and eliminating over 180,000 tons of carbon dioxide through their Music Climate Revolution campaign. So a part of your contribution supports this cause. To potentially win a Tesla Model S Plaid and support Reverb, go to omaze.com/tech for Luddites. The link is down in the description. The main reason seems to be these air-breathing membranes. In the 70s, when iron air batteries were first being studied, the air being breathed in at the anode would have lots of impurities which would react with the electrolyte, causing the battery to lose capacity in just tens or hundreds of cycles. Look at the mess that's produced when you de-rust something with electrolysis. Form Energy's membranes were obtained through the acquisition of a company that was working on zinc air batteries. So while the concept has been known for a long time, the technology required to bring this to fruition on a massive scale didn't exist until recently. Another question that you might be asking yourself is that if this can store more energy for a given amount of weight than lithium-ion batteries, then why don't we use it in electric cars? That's because we're a long way from reaching the theoretical energy density. The rusting reactions will happen mostly on the surface of the iron pellets they're using as the anode. Rust doesn't usually stop at the surface. It's pretty porous and lets oxygen and moisture into the unreacted iron inside. But in their case, naturally, they can't let the whole anode dissolve into powder. So the cycling will probably affect only the outermost layers of the pellets. As a result, their specific energy is likely to be closer to a tenth of the theoretical maximum, or around 80 watt-hour per kilogram. And here's the hidden lead. What do you think the efficiency of these batteries is? Come on, pause the video and make an educated guess in the comments below. Are you ready? So the efficiency of these batteries is 50%. When you're pumping electrons into the anode, some of them might reduce hydrogen ions to hydrogen gas, which wastes energy and is a part of the reason why the cell is so inefficient. Lithium ion is much better at over 90%. Hydrogen is worse, but you can store it basically forever. Plus, you can use it in hydrogen cars. The only way this kind of efficiency can be cost-effective is if the electricity were really cheap. Renewables can have periods of production with low or even negative electricity prices. And that's your main answer to why you're hearing about iron air batteries. There is one final thing you should know about. Remember that their pilot project provides 150 megawatt hour storage? Well, they discharge it over 150 hours, which gives a power density of 1 megawatt. That's not a lot. This probably means that you can't charge or discharge very fast, or they would have clarified somewhere. Rusting is not a particularly fast process, even when catalyzed. Nevertheless, they claim that with 1 acre of land, they can produce 1 to 3 megawatt of power. Lithium-ion battery system, like the one at Hornsdale, can have power densities 20 times higher. But on their website, they also mention that iron air batteries can work well with lithium-ion systems. So the likelihood is that when finally deployed, the norm would be hybrid systems that can supply high power for short periods of time and low power for multiple days. So this is the state of the technology right now. It's promising because they've got a pilot project and they've got a buyer. It's a well-known technology that they're able to take a step further because of recent innovations. And it's backed by people with some pretty deep pockets. Look, the path to grid-scale storage is never simple. Look at Ambri. They were supposed to develop an energy storage system for TerraScale this year. But the company got acquired and the plan seemed to have been shelved. But then recently they received a massive investment from Reliance and other companies totaling $150 million. So just like that, I'm sure we'll see ups and downs for Form Energy too. See, that's why I didn't like the name. For Form. Anyway, we wish them luck. And once again, Thanks to our sponsor, Omaze. You can click on the link in the description below to enter for your chance to win. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Like the video and get into the comments below to see what people are saying about this technology. I'll see you really soon. Bye.